I am Brad Keelor. She is Kaleigh Yost. Find out next on Director's Cut what she thinks about the future of earthquake prediction and resilience. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I am the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call the show Director's Cut. Every week, I sit down with a different GI member who has stories to tell, tales to unfold. We will ask professional questions. We will ask personal questions. All of them will be fun questions. There are 10 of them. We are very happy this week to be joined from the university I will never say the full name of because I always mess it up, Virginia Tech, Kaleigh Yost, PhD student at said institution. Kaleigh, thank you for being with us today.
Happy to be here, Brad.
We are going to have a good time. We will start with you the same exact way we start with every guest. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
All right. So I'm a PhD student, so I wear a lot of different hats and every day looks very different. So I do things from working on writing papers to running numerical analyses to tooling around in my garage, which has turned into a little bit of a mini laboratory for me since COVID shut down the lab I was working in. And on top of my research work, I also take classes, although not over the summer, but just wrapped them up this spring. And I also participate in a lot of extracurriculars. So ASCE, Geo-Institute, Student Leadership Council, Earthquake Engineering Research Institute, Student Leadership Council, as well as some different organizations at Virginia Tech.
So the garage, this is your first bonus question. Is there anything in there that you were able to go out and purchase that you didn't have on campus before quarantine and the shutdown and all that stuff?
You know, it's actually been more convenient to work out of the garage. I've got a nice workbench set up, and the only complaint, I think, is I'm getting sand everywhere, so that's not the most ideal situation, but it's really great because I go out there, I do what I need to do, and then I can just come inside and have lunch and not worry about what's going on until it's time to go back out there, so I think it's worked out pretty well.
That is a great setup. So we mentioned COVID already. It took about 45 seconds here. Your first fun question is, what pre-COVID thing or situation do you hope is now gone forever from society?
So I thought about, I don't know, there's a lot of things, but I think one of them in particular is people at the gym not wiping down their equipment. So my gym has, since COVID started, required you to carry like a spray bottle and a towel with you, and you have to wipe down everything. Like, everything you touch has to get wiped down, and everybody does it, right? Like, it's a great system. So I don't know. I'm hoping that that kind of sticks around because I've seen one too many sweaty bench that I don't want to go close to.
And it is kind of funny because there are a lot of things like this where you're just kind of like, wait a minute, why were we not doing this before?
Yeah. Yeah.
And can you envision, not even necessarily that particular thing, like, I don't know how we stop some of these practices that we've been doing. Like, I think anytime I feel sick, even if I have allergies, I'm probably going to wear a mask in the future. Yep. Like, I just don't feel like there's a hard, I'm not going to do this anymore.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a weird transition. Also, like you said, we'll be watching a movie and somebody will cough and it just kind of makes you cringe, right? Like, you don't want to hear that anymore. So I think that's definitely going to take a while to get over.
I have a hard time with that to begin with. And never watch a public health emergency movie on a plane. Those would be my words, my words of wisdom there. So on Director's Cut, we ask our guests to think back in time a lot. This one doesn't have to go super far for you. You did sort of a unique thing. I don't know that many people do this. You have attended three different universities for all three of your degrees. In your opinion, what are the disadvantages and advantages of doing this?
Sure. Yeah. So I think they're mostly advantages. I got to see three different parts of the country, very different parts of the country, the Midwest, Texas, and Southwest Virginia. I got to learn from so many different people that are experts in what they do. And I got to triple my network, which is really fantastic. So overall, I would say it's been really advantageous that I absolutely don't regret that decision to do that. You know, it's on the disadvantage side, it definitely isn't the most expeditious way to do something. So, you know, when I came to Virginia Tech, I kind of had to take a lot of the coursework that I had already taken when I was doing my master's degree over again, because they like you to kind of get indoctrinated into that particular system and things like that. So it's definitely not the way to go if you're looking to graduate in a quick manner. But overall, I would say it's mostly good things.
So we have to ask technical questions here too. We keep them a little lighter. There's not going to be anything too intense here. I want to ask you about earthquake prediction and the future. This is what we led the show with. What is the most exciting thing to you about the possibilities of earthquake prediction?
Yeah, so I think that the earthquake early warning systems are really the most exciting thing that's kind of coming out along these lines, like Shake Alert, which is being rolled out on the west coast of the U.S. And so these earthquake early warning systems, for those that don't know, it's basically a network of sensors that detects the very first waves, so the P waves, that move the fastest from the source of an earthquake. And it quickly captures the data and sends it to be processed to pretty much determine if the earthquake is significant enough to notify people. And then messaging can go out to let people know that they need to drop cover and hold on. Or they could even trigger actions like to slow down a train so that when the ground starts shaking, the train is not traveling as fast as it was before. And I just think that's so cool. I know that, you know, people will only have a couple of seconds really in some of these situations, but that's just enough time if you're prepared. So somebody told me once, earthquakes don't kill people, buildings kill people. And I would add to that things in buildings kill people as well. So if you get a text message that tells you you need to get under your desk and you have just enough time to do that, I think that has tremendous possibilities for making the environment safer for people that live, especially on the West Coast. And I guess more generally, I think over the past year, people have really been opening up their eyes to how vulnerable their communities are. With COVID going on top of other natural disasters, you know, the wildfires in California, the power outages in Texas, just to name two of them. I think people are really starting to think about how they need to build back better and build back more resilient communities. And I think that those of us in the earthquake engineering community really need to piggyback off that and make sure that earthquake resilience is being considered as well, and as we start, you know, building these cities of the future. So I think those two things in tandem are both really exciting.
So here's another bonus question for you, and you've gotten too early, and I apologize for that. Let's try to envision a day when USGS rolls out something like Shake Alert, or maybe it is Shake Alert, across the entire country. What do you think are going to be the challenges as this spreads into other regions? I can think of something like, you know, we're both in Virginia. If we have a 5.5 in Virginia, depending on where it's located, that could be absolutely devastating because of the geology of the area. What do you see the challenges being as this rolls into other parts of the U.S.?
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge is just going to be public education. I mean, we saw this in Utah over the past year too. People didn't really realize that they could be exposed to such a large earthquake. And that's really a struggle when you're trying to push out a warning system like this. So, you know, I think in Virginia, when we have an earthquake happen, people just think it's really cool. And that, you know, is usually okay. But if we get a bigger one, that might not be so great. So I think just education is a huge component of this, and teaching people what exactly it is that they need to do if they receive an alert like that, because again, it's useless if you don't take any action based on it. So it'll be interesting to see how they approach that.
And shout out to Salt Lake City and the Utah Capitol building on this. I would urge everybody out there in viewer land to check out what they've done to retrofit the Capitol building in Utah. They put, I believe, 65 dampers under the building. They actually raised it up to put these things under. One of the coolest things I've ever gotten to do is go in the basement and check these things out. It's very cool. I would push everybody to do that. We're going to go with another fun question next. In your life, what is the biggest impulse purchase you've ever made, and how did it turn out?
So I love this question because I don't make impulse purchases.
Good answer.
I like to agonize over my purchases for weeks or months at a time. So I very rarely ever make any sort of impulse purchase. But over the past year, you know, we've been going a little stir crazy in the house, and I actually did make an impulse purchase. It wasn't that big, but it was big for me. I purchased a golf putting mat for indoors, so it fits perfectly in our skinny little hallway. But you have to stand inside the room. Like, you can't, there's not enough room for you to bend over in the hallway to putt. You have to be halfway into the room. But yeah, my husband was shocked when it showed up at the door. He's like, I would have never thought you would have bought something like this. And I'm like, yeah, we're going to work on our putting.
So give us some details there. Is there any terraforming on this thing? Is it, does it have one of the things where the ball bounces back to you?
Yeah, it's a very simple return mechanism where it basically just rolls down a hill and rolls back to you. The terraforming hasn't been added yet, but the biggest challenge is the dog likes to grab the golf balls once you hit them. So sometimes they don't actually make it to the hole because they get snatched up before they make it there.
In golf, they call that a hazard.
Yeah.
So we ask two questions of everybody when they come on this show. The first one is the describe your job question. The second one, how did you first get involved with ASCE and GI?
So unfortunately, I'm going to disappoint your viewers because I think my answer is pretty similar to many of your previous interviews.
Well, we're making a point by doing that. It probably involves pizza at some point.
Yeah. So I knew that I wanted to be a civil engineer since I was in middle school, which is kind of crazy. But I distinctly remember my freshman year of college at Notre Dame. I went to it was like a recruiting event for civil engineering. So I don't think we had to declare a major until the end of our first year. And so civil engineering there is pretty a small program. I think there were about 30 people that graduated with me. So it was a small room, and there was definitely pizza there. And I just remember two of the professors who have since become very dear friends and mentors of mine. They were going through and talking about all of the extracurricular activities that you could get involved in if you became a civil engineering major. And one of them was the concrete canoe. And I didn't need to see any more after that. I was hooked. I spent, you know, the next 3 years involved with ASCE, and especially the concrete canoe team. My fondest memory is racing our Lego themed canoe. I think we were at University of Illinois for the regional conference. We never won. University of Wisconsin-Madison always won the canoe races, so we didn't really have a hope there, but it was still a good time.
I gotta tell you, we haven't had a concrete canoe winner on this show yet, and it kind of makes me wonder, who are these people that win the competition? Like, because none of them are GI members.
Yeah, they must have gone into structural engineering. I don't know.
So you mentioned that you wanted to be a civil engineer starting in middle school. Was there a light bulb moment for you, or did it just sort of happen over time and one day somebody asked you and you realized that that's what you wanted to do?
You know, I don't really know. I really liked the idea of designing cities as a whole. Like, I think I was kind of thinking about planning and things like that, and I really liked math, so that it kind of just came together, I guess. And once I decided that was it, I mean, I was, I didn't need to consider anything else, so it worked out pretty well.
That's amazing. The other bonus question I will ask you here, as a fellow graduate of a Jesuit institution, I always felt like it would have been really challenging to get a science or an engineering degree from a Jesuit university because there are so many general courses that you have to take, whether it's philosophy or theology or the foreign language or history or whatever. How did you manage that? How and what ways was it difficult for you?
It was very hard. It's just Notre Dame in general was very hard. You know, I moved in and my three roommates were each valedictorian of their high school. So that was a little intimidating. like you said, especially in the beginning, freshman and sophomore year was real heavy on the I don't remember what they called it there, but the general classes. So I had to take two theology, two philosophy, some sort of literature class. It was a lot. And I don't know, I guess the best part about going to a smaller Jesuit school was the relationships I had with my professors. Mm-hmm. So I really felt like all of the civil engineering professors really cared about us and they wanted their students to succeed. So it was a very nurturing environment and we were all kind of in it together. And the other thing was there were so many engineering courses that were happening at very specific times that those extra classes you had to take, you were usually full of engineers. So I would be in theology 101, but it would be like 95% engineering students, which worked out pretty well for me because I was pretty good at writing. And so as long as you could write better than like 50% of the engineering students in the class, you were in good shape.
Sometimes that can be kind of a low bar, but do you find that it's influenced you in other ways? Are you quoting Voltaire as you're analyzing soils?
I don't know if I would take it that far, but I definitely do appreciate the background. I think it was a very nice liberal arts education in addition to my engineering degree, so I feel pretty lucky.
We will have a couple of more questions about your education, actually three of them in a row at the very end, which will be very exciting when we get to that in a moment. First, information we all must have out here in Director's Cut land. What is the last TV series you saw every episode of?
So my husband and I are definitely binge watchers. So most TV series I've seen every episode of. So the last one was Mad Men. We just finished that. We were kind of late to the game with that one, but we just finished watching that. Right now, we discovered we're getting HBO somehow. I'm not sure which one of my accounts it's coming from, but I don't know how to cancel it. So we started watching The Sopranos, which we also had never seen from the beginning. So we'll watch that one all the way through. And there's always the go-tos, right? So The Office and Veep is one of my favorites as well.
What is the worst TV series that you have toughed it out just to make it to the end because you're a completionist? I don't know that you are a completionist, but have you ever done that?
There have definitely been some shows that I didn't like as much as my husband. He really enjoyed Arrested Development, and I just couldn't get that excited about it. But we did watch it all the way through. But we usually stop. I mean, we started watching Man in the High Castle or something, which a lot of people really like. And we tried. We gave it like two or three episodes. And I'm like, I'm not going to waste my time watching this.
You have to watch enough, though, so that when you enter into a discussion with somebody who's really a big fan, you feel like you have the upper hand and you can offer qualified criticism of why their choice to watch that show is the wrong one.
Yeah, I agree. The other one was I loved Schitt's Creek, and that show is kind of hard to get into from the beginning because the characters are just so outlandish and they're so unlikable. And you really have to watch like the whole first season before you really get it. So that one was another one that I started watching and my husband was like not into. And eventually he came around and we had to start it all from the beginning.
It's Canadian TV. I always think it takes a little while. I don't know what it is about the character development, but it always takes a little bit longer. So we shift from that to something much more meaningful and serious. You were involved with something at Notre Dame called Engineering to Empower. How did your involvement with this impact your approach to your education and what's going to become your career? I guess the first thing is to explain to everybody a little bit about what Engineering to Empower is and what you did.
Sure. So Engineering to Empower, E2E, as we called it, was the research team I was a part of as an undergrad at Notre Dame. And it was formed in response to the 2010 Haiti earthquake and the devastating housing crisis that ensued. So you're probably aware that after that earthquake, just millions of people were out of homes and had no shelter in Haiti. And there were a lot of problems that kind of came about with, you know, people that had good intentions in the response to this crisis, but it just didn't really play out. You know, there were folks coming in and building homes that were remaining empty. You know, the Haitians didn't want to live in them, or they couldn't afford to live in them. Just a variety of different issues. And so this group was kind of formed to respond to that in a different way. So the tagline was listen, innovate, empower. And the idea was that you would actually consider the people who this problem was impacting and talk to them and really understand all of the impediments to solving the problem. And then use the connection that we had to the university to really come up with some cool engineering solutions that maybe they wouldn't have had access to in Haiti. And then the third piece, the empower piece, was actually bringing that innovation to Haiti and empowering the communities to get involved and actually come up with their own ideas for how to solve this problem in a way that was, you know, consistent with their culture and consistent with what they really wanted. So that was kind of, I guess, the background of it. And I just absolutely loved being a part of this group. It was such a powerful experience to have a research team that had such a holistic and people-centered view of things. You know, we had people on our team that were looking at everything from how the beams were going to perform in the structure that we were designing during an earthquake, how the walls were going to withstand hurricane force winds. But we also had people that were looking at, you know, culturally, what does a home look like in Haiti? You know, what do people want their homes to look like? What kind of construction materials do they even have there? And how can this become something that's actually sustainable for them to move forward with in the future? And so that interdisciplinary collaboration was just so inspiring to be a part of. And it really helped me learn early on that there are rarely problems that only engineers can solve, right? So I think sometimes as engineers, we like to just do some calculations and slap our solution on something, but that is not usually the best way to approach these problems. So I guess the second part of that question is how that impacted my education and my career. It absolutely pushed me to stay in earthquake engineering. That, you know, the dichotomy between the Haiti earthquake and the New Zealand earthquakes that kind of happened around the same time was really powerful to me, kind of seeing the loss of life difference and how two countries were able to recover or not. That was really important for me to understand, and still is. I mean, my research is still involved in the New Zealand earthquakes now as a PhD student. So I think, you know, it definitely inspired me to stay in earthquake engineering, and I hope further along in my career that I'll be able to create and work on some teams that have the same kind of mindset where it's very interdisciplinary and collaborative and very much formed with the intent of empowering the community that it's meant to serve.
So your bonus question there, and I think this is probably the last bonus question, so you can relax easy after this one. One of the things that I think about this is it must be extraordinarily difficult to approach this with the mindset of someone who's trying to recover in Haiti from that event. I think with New Zealand and, you know, other events that happen in more developed countries, wealthier countries, I think there's always just the, you know, if you throw money at it, there are going to be people there who know what the solution needs to be, and there's a process, and people fill out forms, and the machinations of government happen, and everything is okay after a certain amount of time. That's definitely not true in a place like Haiti. How did you guys get yourselves into that mindset to think about a solution, whether it was for recovery, future mitigation, whatever, that people on the ground would be able to use? Like, it was almost like you would have to take yourself out of your body and your experiences to be able to do that. How did you approach that?
Yeah, so I guess a couple of different ways. You know, the professors that were a part of this initiative had been on the ground in Haiti immediately after the earthquake doing reconnaissance work. So they had that kind of hands-on experience right away. And we had a very strong partnership with some folks in Haiti, and some of them actually came and visited us as well. So we really had a close connection with the community. But you're right, I mean, it's impossible, you know, to imagine yourself in that situation. So we did a really good job of bringing the ideas to Haiti. So they would set up, I think they called them innovation incubators, and they would host these little events where they would ask people in the community to come and solve a problem together. And so some of this innovation was actually going on in the communities, and it was really community driven. And we were just kind of there to facilitate it. And I think that was a really positive way to approach the problem.
That is great. So now we're going to, this one, yeah, you don't really have to think back. This is more of a current one. And we'll focus on Virginia Tech for this one. And this is, you're the second student who's been on Director's Cut. So we had to put something in here that would be a message and of inspiration and awe to all the other grad students in the field right now. For you, what has been the biggest challenge and the biggest reward for working with your advisor?
Sure. So I'd say there's plenty on both ends of that question. On the fun side, I guess, as you may or may not know, so Virginia Tech, my current institution, and University of Texas, my master's degree institution, have a bit of a friendly rivalry going on between the geotech departments. And my advisor here is very good friends with several professors over at Texas. So they kind of like to dialogue. And like I said, it's a bit of a friendly rivalry. So my advisor, when I first got here, liked to joke with some of the professors from UT about how I was saying that the classes at Virginia Tech are so much better and professors are much better, and, you know, and it's just such a, you know, great place and, you know, just trash talking. And of course, I wasn't saying any of these things, right? So most of the professors at Texas, I think, knew he was joking, but I think some of them maybe were like a little questionable. So I had to straighten a couple things out, but it was all in good fun. I guess more seriously, my advisor, Dr. Green, he works so much, like all the time. And so that's kind of a hard standard to live up to, right? I know some grad students that say, you know, I like to get into the office before my advisor gets there and I don't leave until they're gone. I could never do that. I would be living in the engineering building. So I guess those are two challenges. But in terms of rewards, I this is an unpopular opinion probably, but I love being a PhD student. I think it's so great. Maybe I have a little bit more perspective because I worked for a little while and came back, but it's so great. I have the independence to make my own schedule and do things when I want to do them. I get to work with the like leaders in my field. I mean, my advisor is, you know, a world expert on earthquake engineering, and that's what I'm studying, and that's just so cool. And the other professors in my department as well, like I've gotten to collaborate with just really, really smart people who are working on really cool projects. And yeah, I think in general, I just find the whole experience to be very, very rewarding. Getting to work on projects that you're interested in and being able to spend so much time just trying to figure out these complex problems is a pretty fun way to spend your four to five to 6 years.
So all you PhD students watching, well, master's students, even undergrads watching, those maybe things to look for in an advisor, look for some friendly rivalries. That always helps. So the final question is a fun one. It is related to the three institutions that you have attended. They are three sports powerhouses in multiple sports. We have Notre Dame, we have Texas, we have Virginia Tech. Which team are you the biggest fan of?
So I bleed blue and gold. I'm Irish all the way. I do root for the other teams as long as they're not playing the Irish. It's a bit of a sore subject in my house because my husband did his undergrad at Virginia Tech. So we're also pretty big Hokies fans. But I've had the unfortunate experience, both at Texas and at Virginia Tech, of attending a home football game when the team is playing Notre Dame. And I can tell you, it is very unpleasant to sit in the student section at Texas or Virginia Tech with a Notre Dame jersey on. I would not recommend that.
Although I have to imagine it is about 6,000 times better than if you had gone to Michigan or Purdue, for example.
That's true. That is very true. You know, it's for other schools, Notre Dame's a bit of a novelty when they get to play them. But for us, I mean, Texas and Virginia Tech until very recently were not schools that we were playing regularly. So it wasn't really that big of a problem for me until the past couple of years.
Well, I said before the show, for Notre Dame, for me, it's the gold helmets in every sport. They drive me insane, whether it's baseball or hockey or football. It doesn't matter. I hate the gold helmets, and I've never been a Notre Dame fan. But I think that's okay. There are as many Notre Dame fans as there are non-Notre Dame fans in the world, I think. So you made it through all 10 questions. Everybody does, but we still celebrate it like it's some kind of achievement. They were great answers. If you enjoyed watching this, viewers, and I think you did because you're still here at the end, click on that little button that says subscribe. Click the bell to get notifications. We will let you know, not me personally, but a bot in YouTube land, will let you know every time we post a new video to the YouTube channel, which is frequently. So, Kaleigh, thank you for being with us today. This was a good time.
Thanks again.
Very thoughtful answers, and I'm positive everybody appreciates that. This was a great interview. So thanks again for being here, and we will see everybody next week.